I shall go to see what the end's going to be.
I open my mouth to the Lord, and I won't turn back. I will go, I shall go, to see what the end's going to be.
I open my mouth to the Lord, and I won't turn back. I will go, I shall go, to see what the end's going to be.
To Calvary. 1 Samuel, chapter 15, beginning at verse 10. And I will be reading from the New International Version. Then the word of the Lord came to Samuel, "I am grieved that I have made Saul king, because he has turned away from me and has not carried out my instructions." Samuel was troubled, and he cried out to the Lord all that night. Early in the morning, Samuel got up and went to meet Saul. But he was told, "Saul has gone to Carmel. There he has set up a monument in his own honor and has turned and gone on down to Gilgal." When Samuel reached him, Saul said, "The Lord bless you. I've carried out the Lord's instructions." But Samuel said, "What then is this bleating of sheep in my ears? What is this lowing of cattle that I hear?" Saul answered, "The soldiers brought them from the Amalekites. They spared the best of the sheep and cattle to sacrifice to the Lord your God, but we totally destroyed the rest." "Stop," Samuel said to Saul. "Let me tell you what the Lord said to me last night." "Tell me," Saul replied. Samuel said, "Although you were once small in your own eyes, did you not become the head of the tribes of Israel? The Lord anointed you king over Israel, and he sent you on a mission saying, 'Go and completely destroy those wicked people, the Amalekites. Make war on them until you have wiped them out.' Why did you not obey the Lord? Why did you pounce on the plunder and do evil in the eyes of the Lord?" "But I did obey the Lord," Saul said. "I went on the mission the Lord assigned me. I completely destroyed the Amalekites and brought back Agag, their king. The soldiers took sheep and cattle from the plunder, the best of what was devoted to God, in order to sacrifice them to the Lord, your God, at Gilgal." But Samuel replied, "Does the Lord delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as much as in obeying the voice of the Lord? To obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed is better than the fat of rams." I'll stop right there. So endeth the reading of God's precious word. You may be seated. By reading these chosen verses, you somewhat get a smidget in terms of what direction the message is going this morning. And let me give you this topic, because we're going to be exploring this for at least about 2 or 3 Sundays, because there's so much in here about the personality of Saul. Until if I was to try to preach all of this morning, it would take us about maybe 3 or 4 this afternoon. Now, if you don't mind staying, I don't mind preaching it. But I have a feeling that some of y'all would walk out. So in order to be appropriate for the time, we're just going to look at the beginning of this and then continue the overlapping going on from Sunday to Sunday until the Holy Spirit concludes it. But our main thought is a character analysis, of Saul - the man - the king Disaster. A character analysis, looking at, weighing the good and the bad, the assets that Saul had over against his liabilities. And looking at the man first, then looking at him as king, and then finally looking at his disaster. What I want to do in terms of setting our minds and getting a clear picture of what has happened or what did happen to Saul, because Saul, believe it or not, is a representation of all of humanity. Each of us as followers of Christ, and we'll look at that later on. In the year 1886, a writer by the name of R.L. Stevenson wrote a book entitled The Strange Case of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. The book was based on a true story of a famous doctor in London, England, by the name of Dr. Jekyll. Dr. Jekyll was a prominent surgeon in London, England in the 19th century. Well respected, very much influential. He had powerful inroads in the halls of Parliament. He was reverend by all of those that knew him. He was honored for his skill and his ability in medicine. Dr. Jekyll's fame had even spread over here from England to America. But with all of these achievements that he had, with all of the accolades that he had, Dr. Jekyll had a very serious and damaging problem. Dr. Jekyll was a schizophrenic, which means that he had a psychotic disorder, which represented itself in a split personality. He had a two-part, multiple personality. One side of him was good, the other side was evil. The Dr. Jekyll was a good guy. Mr. Hyde was the evil person. During the day that he lived, and almost about 2 decades, it was noted that Dr. Jekyll was a man that everybody looked up to. But when the sun went down at night, his temperament changed, and he became a sinister, homicidal killer. Thus, the title was given to him, and you've heard this title before, Jack the Ripper. For approximately 20 years, he eluded police by picking his victims in isolated places where there were no witnesses, no one to see him, and most of these persons that he killed were women. They were in the red light districts, or either in brothels, or else they were barmaids. Now, you wonder, why did I begin this message talking about this man who had a split, a dual personality? And you're trying to figure out what is the connection between Saul and Dr. Jekyll. Amen? What does Saul have in common with this notorious character? Well, I will tell you very simply, one common denominator, and that is decline. And keep that word in your mind, decline. Dr. Jekyll started out with prominence, just like the sun is shining out there now. He had a great future ahead of him, but sooner or later, he declined and he went into disaster. Both of these men were on a one-way journey to nowhere. Now there is here a spiritual principle, and especially this spiritual principle is applicable to Saul's life. When God is substituted for self, there can be but one outcome, and that is self-destruction. This principle is as old as the ages and as humanity. For if you leave God, you forfeit life. If you remove God out of the center of life, then life begins a downward spiral. As followers of Jesus Christ, we must be on our guard to fight against this sin of pride, for pride is destructive. In fact, in the book of Proverbs, when it talks about the seven deadly sins, pride heads the list of all of the sins. For all of the other sins of greed and jealousy and whatever else you might name come out of pride. Pride is like a plant that goes in the ground and its roots spread out and go everywhere. Now, I want us to analyze what happened to Saul in his decline. So you and I will not fall victim to this sin in our own personal lives. It has been said that Satan does not want our souls outright, that Satan only wants a mortgage on our souls. Satan is content to take a lien on your soul and my soul for $1,000, figuratively speaking, if he cannot get a lien for $100,000. And you got to understand that Satan is in no hurry to get us. He can wait for the day of foreclosure, which is the day of death. All Satan wants is to have his hand in our lives. Satan's cleverest ploy is to mix the good with the bad. He covers his poison of evil as a sugar-coated pill. He knows that we won't accept sin and the devastating effects of it in its bare form. Satan's choicest agents are those individuals who feel as though that they are above this. They are attracted people. They have a lot of influence. They have a lot of power. You remember Esau and Jacob? Esau was more appealing than Jacob, but Jacob was the chosen one. Now, an individual can be beautiful, they can be wise, they can be cultured, they can have good morals, they can be useful, they can be noble, they can be generous, they can live for other people, do in terms of good deeds for other folk, but in essence, they are living for themselves. And in the end, they become self-destroyed like Saul. In 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 17 and 18, God says, "Therefore, come out from them and be separate, says the Lord. Touch no unclean thing, and I will receive you. I will be a father to you. You will be my sons and my daughters, says the Lord Almighty." Now, in order that you can see this clearly, we're going to start with Saul's assets. And then from there, we're going to go down and see how he slowly degenerated. What did Saul have to offer? Well, in order to understand the total picture, you got to start reading in 1 Samuel at chapter 8 and read all the way to chapter 20 in 1 Samuel. Begin at chapter 8, go all the way to chapter 20. That gives you the total picture of the man and who he was and what happened to him. Let me see whether I can distill it and give it to you in a nutshell. God's people Israel one day told Samuel. Samuel was the priest, the prophet, and the judge of Israel. Amen? And the people came to Samuel, who were the elders of the 12 tribes, and said to Samuel, "Samuel, we want a king just like Pleasant Green. We want to be like other nations. We want an earthly monarchy. We don't want God to lead us anymore. We don't want a theocracy, but we want a monarchy. We want an earthly man to give us direction. We're tired of God telling us what to do." Does that sound familiar? So Samuel was upset. So he went to God in prayer and said, "Lord, you know, your people have come to me and said they no longer want you." Well, Saul was offended because he felt as though that they were also implying him personally. "We don't want you over us as priest, a prophet, and judge." God replied to Samuel and said, "Samuel, don't get upset. And let me say it my way. Don't get upset. The folk ain't nothing, got nothing to do with you. They are rejecting me. They don't want me to rule over them." But to show you in terms of how long-suffering, how gracious God is, God said, "Samuel, look here. This is what I'm going to do." He said, "Don't get upset. Don't worry about it." He said, "Go ahead and give them who they think they want. Go ahead. But I'm still going to rule this thing. But you go ahead and you let them have who they think they want." So they cast lots, and they went by the tribes. And after they cast the lots, they came down to the smallest tribe, called the tribe of Benjamin. And you remember, Benjamin was the brother of Joseph, born to Rachel, and when she had him, she died giving birth to Benjamin. He was the baby in the family. So there was a tribe named after Benjamin. And when they got down to the tribe of Benjamin, then they took each family, family by family, until they got down to a family and the head of that was called Kish. K-I-S-H. Kish was the father of Saul. And when they started to examine, then God told Samuel, "This is who I want to give them." Now, let's look at Samuel. What kind of person was Samuel? Samuel, we are told by the writer here, was taller than anybody else in his tribe. And not only was he tall, but we are told he was a handsome booger. Tall, dark, handsome. Yeah. And not only was he tall, dark, and handsome, but he was shy, he was bashful, he was retiring. In fact, when Samuel got ready to crown him and to have his coronation as king, we're told that he was hiding. Where was Samuel hiding? He was hiding among the baggage. And in the scripture says, the stuff, to let you know that he did not want kingship. Now, I'm skipping a whole lot of this. Anyway, I want you to read it for yourself. You gonna read it? That don't you fool me now and go home and forget about this. I want you to read this narrative because it has some blessing for you, and it has in terms of some spiritual applications that are needed in this day and time that we're living in. After Saul was chosen, and Samuel was the one who anointed him, Samuel told Saul, "Now look, this is what God wants you to do, blah, blah, blah." Because it was spelled out in Deuteronomy chapter 17, verse 14, in terms of what an earthly king was to do, his responsibilities, and how he was to rule over God's people. Now, you got to understand this. God did not let the people have Saul to have a monarchy to do what he wanted to do. It was still a theocracy, which meant that God told Samuel, Samuel told Saul, and Saul told the people. You get it? You get the declension there? God, Samuel the prophet, then to Saul, then to the people. But never Saul doing his thing his way when he felt like doing it. Does that sound familiar in this pop culture that we're living in now? Okay, come on, talk to me this morning now. So Saul, he is crowned king. And God, to make certain that Saul knew that it was God's decision for him to be crowned king, not only did he give him Samuel to be his counselor, his prayer man, to give him the instructions that God had given him, but God also touched the hearts of some men who became warriors and soldiers for Samuel. And God also, he touched Saul's heart, and in touching Saul's heart, at one juncture, Saul did some prophesying with other prophets. So he showed an insight in terms of spiritual discernment. The young man who started guiding the nation of Israel, Saul was 30 years old when he began his mission. And he reigned for 42 years until he was in his 70s, going into the 80s, before disaster came. Saul started out as a great king and reminds me in terms of paralleling. And again, I said this before, going back to our president now, when he was put in office, oh, there were a lot of people that were whooping and hollering, and they were having parades, and they were saying, now we will be delivered, and we will be escorted into our Canaan. But now that he's at the end of his tenure, a lot of people who were for him then now are condemning him. Amen? All right. Now, that's the reason why in the New Testament, God, through Paul, said, don't try to please people, for people will turn on you like a venomous snake. You please God. God takes care of the folk. But if you try to please the folk first, then you lose them and God, and you ain't got nobody but yourself left. Amen? Let me show the downward spiral here. And I'm going to be through in about 10 more minutes. Is that all right? All right. I guess you're saying, Pastor, you've never preached this short before. No, I haven't. Because a whole lot of things are coming into the picture. Looking at his qualifications, looking at his promise, looking at what was ahead in his future, looking at what Saul could have been, but later on did not become. Let me show you the downward spiral. And also let me inject this. Saul also had a good family too. He had two sons and two daughters. And you're familiar with Jonathan, who was a close friend to David. So he had a lot of good folk surrounding him. And that reminds me, and I've said this multiple times before, you can be blessed to grow up in a religious home, in a godly home, with godly parents. But that's no guarantee that you're going to become what God wants you to become. Because some of the most notorious criminals have come out of religious homes. In fact, it has been noted that even ministers, preachers, have turned sour and have gone down the trail of no return. So pedigree does not guarantee that you're going to be great in your life. Let me say it again. Pedigree. You know what pedigree is? Your upbringing. The blessings that God has given you. The endowments that God has given you in terms of your skill and your abilities and this sort of thing. Pedigree does not guarantee success in a person's life. Now look at the picture from the opposite side. There have been individuals that have come out of poverty, have come out of nothing, really have come out of hell's kitchen, and God has used them, and they have risen to high heights. They have blessed humanity. And then on the other side, those that were blessed to come out of these conditions ended up what? Destroying themselves and carrying other people down with them. That's the reason why Chuck Swindoll said that admonition in the Old Testament that says, train up a child in the way that it should go. When it is old, it won't depart from it. That is a generic statement. That is not explicit. Because a lot of children have come out of good homes and turned out to be devils. And then on the other end, a lot of children have come out of destructive homes. Everything against them. And yet they have risen to become good and great people. Amen. Well, I'm skipping over about 10 pages here. No, I don't have that many written. Now, let me give you four basic themes that shows how Saul started coming down. First, defection, chapter 13, defection, D-E-F-E-C-T-I-O-N, defection, and I'll give an example of that in a few minutes. The second step was decline, or the word declension. Decline means to go down. Sometimes it's slow, sometimes it's fast. Might be in a spiral, but you're still on a downward spiral. The third is degeneration. Degeneration. Defection is chapter 13. Decline is chapter 14. Degeneration is chapter 15. Lastly, disaster. Disaster. Starting at chapter 18. And going to the end of the book. Defection, decline, degeneration, disaster. Let's start out with the first, defection. Chapter 13. The story was told there that after Saul has been crowned king, and he has all of this going for him, Samuel is his counselor, his prophet, his priest. He's got God telling Samuel what to tell him. He's got the people with him. He's got a good family with him. He's all that a king should be from a physical standpoint and even inwardly. For at the beginning, Saul demonstrates the highest traits of humility, the highest traits of being an individual that wants God to rule his life. Okay, now, the reason why I keep on hammering on that is because I want you to see the extreme from this to this. In the 13th chapter of 1 Samuel, God, in order to prove to Saul that he was going to use him and that he was going to demonstrate his power and his presence, the Israelites were faced with a battle by the Philistines. And being faced with this battle, the Philistine army had something like about 120,000. Saul only had maybe about 30 or 40,000 men. So Samuel told Saul, wait 7 days, and I will come to you at Gilgal, and I will tell you what God wants you to do. So Saul waited the 7 days. Samuel didn't show up. And after day 8 and 9, some of his soldiers started to defecting from his army. They started to go in AWOL. They started leaving him. They started losing faith in Saul. The people start grumbling against Saul. Saul got scared. He got anxious. So what did he do? He felt as though that Samuel wasn't going to make it, so he went to the place of sacrifice, and he took the prerogative of the priest and offered the sacrifice for the battle, which was not his prerogative to do. Samuel was the one that had to do that. After he had broken God's law and commandment and did what was wrong, Samuel shows up. And Samuel asked Saul, what did you do? And Saul, you can imagine, he's stammering. He never stammered a day in his life. Well, my soldiers, they were leaving me, yeah, and folk were talking, and it looked like that they were going to hang me on a tree and all this kind of thing, and I got scared. So when you didn't show up at the appointed time that you told me, I felt as though, well, wasn't nothing wrong for me to take over the priestly function and offer up the sacrifice. Samuel looked at Saul, and you know what he said to him. You are the biggest fool in the world. Ah, step number one. He had no business stepping into the authority where God had appointed Samuel. Number one. We together? All right. Let's go to step two. He's coming down a little bit further. He apologizes to Samuel, by the way, and says, okay, I won't do this anymore. The next step was they were still fighting the Philistines. Come on there and go with me. I love to tell Old Testament stories because you can put yourself into it mentally. See yourself in the story. They're still fighting the Philistines. Amen. And the Philistines have the Israelite army surrounded on three sides. And Saul is getting anxious. So, not benign to Saul, Jonathan, his son, sneaks out of camp with his armor bearer. Are we together? and watch him sneaking through the night, and he goes up to the outpost of the Philistine army. Now, this outpost was on a high mountain, and on one side was nothing but just sheer cliffs and rocks going up this way. So they felt secure in that post because they felt as though ain't no way anybody way down there can climb up the face of this mountain, and it's nothing but just straight flat rock. So Jonathan, look here how God does awesome stuff when men say it can't be done. Jonathan gets his armor bearer and he goes to the cliff, to that rock. And Jonathan says, his armor bearer, he says, I think, in so many words, I think we can climb this cliff. And the armor bearer said, well, if you say so, we're going to climb it. So slowly, Jonathan and the armor bearer, they start to pulling themselves up the cliff where the Philistines thought that it was impossible for anybody to come up that side. Finally, they reached the top. And when they reached the top, Jonathan told his armor bearer, he said, we're going to call out. And if they respond, we're going to attack them. And that's exactly what they did. And we are told by the writer that Jonathan and his armor bearer killed 20 men. Now, you know Jonathan and his armor bearer cannot destroy the whole Philistine army. Well, after they killed the 20 men, God brought confusion in the whole camp of the Philistines. And when Jonathan killed these 20 men, the rest of the army thought that the Israelites had invaded them and was getting ready to destroy them. And when God got through, the Philistines were slaughtering one another with the sword. Ain't God great? Jonathan didn't have to raise no more sword because God got rid of the rest of them. Now, this is getting good to me. I don't know about you. The news reaches Saul. And Saul says, we're going to go after the Philistines. And he gives a death sentence, which is dumb and stupid. He said to his soldiers, I don't want any of you all to eat anything for a whole day. Whoever breaks my decree, I'm going to kill them. Well, when he made this death sentence, Jonathan wasn't there. He was fighting the enemy. So when God brought confusion and had the enemy army to be destroyed, and when Saul and his army started after them, instead of being able to catch them, they were so weak from not having eaten for a whole day, they couldn't run anymore. So what they did, they took the plunder, the cattle, the sheep, the goats and everything, and they were so famished until they killed the animals to get something to eat. But then they violated God's law. Instead of when they killed the animals, instead of draining the blood out of the animal, they ate the animals with the blood in them, which was a violation of in terms of Leviticus. So they violated the law because of the stupid edict that Saul had given. And then when Saul found out that Jonathan, his son, coming back, saw some honey, and Jonathan started eating the honey. And when Saul found out that Jonathan broke his decree, he decided, I'm going to kill my son. The people ran up and told Saul, no, you're not, because if it had not been for Jonathan, we would not have won this battle. So they intervened, and they saved Jonathan from his own father. Samuel came again. And Samuel said to Saul, Let me say it this way, if I say it my way, you're the biggest fool that I ever seen in my life. You never learn. You see how he kept on messing up? Now, in this second step, what happened? Pride came out of him. Notice when we read the 15th chapter, it said that Saul had built a monument to himself. That suggests that he no longer looked to Jehovah, but now he's looking to Saul. Well, let me give you two spiritual applications. Are you ready? Some of y'all are going to sleep. How are you going to write anything and you're sleeping? The first spiritual application is this. Want to have a vital condition for a full life of purpose and meaning, you must be obedient to the will of God. To have a vital life, a life of power, that's going to have purpose and meaning, you must be obedient to God's will. That hasn't changed. Same thing today. For God doesn't change in terms of who he is and his law. If any of us as followers of Christ, if you want to have a rich, full life, I'm not just talking about physical blessing, but I'm talking about inward, a purpose, a meaning, a direction. You must obey the will of God. When you get out of God's will, that's when your life starts to going down here. That's when you become a Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. You become confused. You don't know what direction your life is going. And Saul now is entering into the syndrome of a Dr. Jekyll and a Mr. Hyde. Oh! And you know, I've seen some Christians in the 60 years I've been in church. I've seen some Christians that were Dr. Jekylls and Mr. Hydes. I know you don't want to say amen. You're scared. But it's true. They present one face this way. And then when they get with their crowd, they present another face. That's Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. One thing we can say about Paul. Wherever Paul was, whoever he was with, Paul was Paul. He wasn't going to put on for nobody. If you didn't like him, he didn't care. If you didn't accept his teaching, he didn't care. He was going to give you what God had given him, and he moved on about his business. We need in this day and time, and there's a lot of talk going about in terms of praying for the conditions of our society. And many of you all know about the gathering that was here Wednesday night of last week in terms of praying for our nation and for our leaders and blah, blah, blah. But let me tell you this. Everything, and if you look at biblical direction from Genesis to Revelation, anything that God changes, first of all, his people have to change. God doesn't change circumstances arbitrarily. If my people, I think there is in Jeremiah chapter 17, where God tells Jeremiah, the heart of man is what? Deceitfully wicked. Do you know what that means, the word deceitfully wicked? You can't figure it out. It's so debased. How many of y'all remember a radio program used to come on in the 40s? Now I know I'm exposing my age, and you already know that I'm old, so it don't matter. But this was before televisions became prominent. Because, you know, TVs didn't come out until the late 40s, early 50s. And then they were number just snow when you look at them. And if you wanted to have a color TV, you would buy a plastic film that had the colors of the rainbow, and you would tape it around over the face of the TV, and then you would say, we got color TV. Now, yo, you young folk, y'all don't know nothing about that, you know. And see, some of the old folk, they ain't going to tell you that because they shame. But I'm going to expose them. And I know I'm drifting a little bit away from this, but I remember in my neighborhood, TVs then, well, you know, it was just in its infancy stage, and they cost so much, and the technology was not real good. And there was a minister friend of my father that lived a block down the street, had bought a big old TV, at least, you know, when you're a child, TVs look big, you know, it could have been, I don't know, 10-inch screen. But anyway, after school at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, there was a program that came on that every kid in the neighborhood went and sat in his living room and watched Howdy Doody. How many of y'all remember Howdy Doody? Okay, I knew eventually somebody will admit they're old. Yeah. Mr. Bob. Oh, I used to love Howdy Doody and Mr. Bob, and it would be about 30 kids in his living room, and we'd just be sitting there, and everybody be laughing and talking, and his wife, she was so kind, she would go and make sandwiches for everybody and give us maybe Kool-Aid, and boy, we loved going there. My mama whipped me every day about going there. I didn't care. Next day, I went right back down in that living room because I wanted to see Bob and Howdy Doody. But anyway, we would listen to the radio since Daddy couldn't afford a TV. And listening to the radio, you had to use your imagination. And that's what is lost in this technological age now. Folk ain't got no imagination no more because the electronics tell you, show you, give you, and everything else. But anyway, I'm not going to get into that. Anyway, there was a program that came on called The Shadow. If y'all remember that radio? Okay. I was hoping I wasn't the only alien here on this planet. And you remember the announcer, whenever The Shadow would come on, he would make this statement. What evil lurks in the hearts of men? Only the shadow knows. And boy, when he would say that, I would just get goosebumps and I would just get chilled, you know. But then when I started thinking about it, Rem Davis, that statement is just as pertinent now as it was then. What evil lurks in the hearts of men today? Now, the shadow don't know. But I'll tell you somebody else who does know, you got it. God knows the deceitfulness of our hearts. He knows in terms of the evil that's down in us. Well, let me give you this other spiritual application, and then I'm through. When we let self rule in our lives, we miss the best and we entertain the worst. When we let self rule in our lives, we miss the best and we entertain the worst. Saul was his own worst enemy. Saul was his own worst enemy. Why do you think God permitted chapter 2 of Philippians to be a part of our daily spiritual nourishment, where it talks about Jesus left his kingship, power, authority. John tells us in chapter 1, the world was made by him. The world exists because of him. The world holds together because of him. But when he came to his own, what? His own received him not. The very folk that he made and gave them existence, they rejected him. But as many as did what? Receive him, to them he gave the power. We're told in that second chapter of Philippians that he left more than what Saul had. He was over all the angels. 420 elders had all power. He put that aside and came down in this mess, humbled himself, and donned the skin of man, and then became what? A servant. He didn't get upset. It didn't rattle his cage. He didn't feel as though that he was disrespected. He didn't feel as though that men, they snubbed their nose at him, because he came for the purpose of giving his life as a ransom for all of us. Now, if Jesus, who is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, if he can do this, to come down and to save your soul and my soul, and to offer us what? Salvation, and to offer us in terms of what? Sanctification, so that we can live with the Father forever. If he can do that for you and me, give up his life in order that we might live, what do you think that he requires of you and me to follow him? He says what? Deny yourself. Do you know what the word deny means? It means thinking nothing about yourself. Not thinking you're somebody. Giving up yourself. And then after you deny yourself, then you what? Which means what? A burden. Pain. And then after you've done all of that, you can't follow me until you meet these requirements. Then if you meet these requirements, then you're qualified to what? Follow me. Not to walk ahead of me, but follow me.